to get by Benning. Darnell Nurse left it in the corner. Gets up center. Perry! Scoops! Corey Perry!
Well, you're able to shake away from Solani. It's given away to Solani. Around in front. Score! Teemu Solani with the steal.
Three in the face. One. Score! Off the floor! On the floor! Paul Kariya!
Well, we're back with a morning edition of the Forever Mighty post-game show. Tough day yesterday for a lot of us. We if you didn't see it, we didn't do a show right after the game because I missed probably about 90% of the game. I only really saw overtime. And it wouldn't have been a great show to go on there and try and talk about the game, only seeing a little bit of it. So I ended up watching the rest of it last night on replay. But so we're here now, and it was a pretty decent game. I mean, the Ducks end up coming out with a win, so now they've won three in a row. Carolina's a pretty good opponent, so not a bad outcome.
Yeah, I'm loving the fact that the moms are around, because apparently that's just been our good luck charm. I thought that was the whole trip, though.
Maybe.
But yeah. I didn't see them. They may not have been, because they didn't really ever go up to look at them. But yeah, like, you only got to see overtime. I only got to see the first two periods. They never went to them.
Yeah, but the Ducks also never scored. The second and third, they didn't show. And they made like a big, I think they made like a big deal about it on the last game. Like, it was the last bit of the road trip. They kept saying, like, oh, can we keep them for the entire trip or whatever.
Why wouldn't they? That's weird.
I think because, well, I guess it's not like it's that much farther if you're going from Nashville to Carolina,
so. Yeah, and then you're going up to Washington, and then the boys are going back home. We'll go wherever we are. We're already on the East Coast.
Yeah.
It makes sense.
I don't know.
Man, the Ducks are just cheap,
I guess. But so let's look at some of the stuff that happened before the game. Josh Mahura got called up, didn't play. He was a healthy scratch. Andre Schuster was sent down to make room for that, which, I mean, if you're going to bring Josh Mahura up, I would think you might as well play him, but they wanted to play Jakob Larsson again with Josh Manson, and they had Hampus Lindholm come back off the IR, and they wanted to play him with Brandon Montour, who seems to be his new partner for this season. And because Lindholm comes off the IR, Cali Kostola gets sent down, which I guess we kind of expected. He was healthy scratched for the last two games. So, I mean, I guess the good news in that sense, it doesn't look like it was an injury. He just was scratched because guys were coming back into the lineup.
It's kind of weird. They do this whole shuffle all the time, it seems like. I think, like, they wanted to bring up Mahura, and they probably would have played him, but I think it was like in the morning that's when they realized they're going to take Lindholm off the IR and then see how he did in the morning, and if he was good enough to play, they, you know, game time decision is what Randy Carlyle said. So ends up being that he's good to go. So I feel like Mahura will probably end up coming right back down anyways if he's not going to get considerable time, or if they don't want to burn too much of Larsson playing. So who knows? Shuffle is just odd to me.
We know if the Ducks keep winning, Randy Carlyle is going to put out the exact same lines because he's not going to change anything at all.
Saving his job.
Yeah, exactly. Victor Rask, funny thing, I think we even mentioned this when we did 31 for 31 way back in the summer, but he's, I think, only about six games back from one of the most bizarre injuries ever, where he cut his hand cutting sweet potatoes in his kitchen. We've seen some bizarre injuries before, but the fact that he missed like a quarter of the season because of it was pretty crazy.
Yeah, one of those other crazy stories is Dustin Penner pulling a back muscle, eating one of I think his quote was one of his wife's what was it? It was like one of her perfect pancakes or something like that, and that's where he got the nickname Pancakes, is just because he pulled a back muscle eating pancakes and had to miss a game because of it. That was a few years back. I actually have a story. It's way less impressive than Victor Rask. Apparently, he missed 20 games because he almost, lopped off his arm or something. I actually one time drunkenly was really hungry and I wanted burgers. All we had were turkey burgers and they were frozen. And so the patties were stuck together.
Yeah.
And so instead of getting like a butter knife to separate them, to cook them, I got a really sharp knife and held the patties like this. And I ended up cutting my finger. I got a scar there. You can't really see it, but I ended up cutting myself trying to separate two turkey burgers. My wife still doesn't let me forget that.
I'm sure,
so that's my story.
I'm sure there's probably more injuries that occur like that too, but they don't. They never come out. They just come out as
like that
injury or something, or a hand injury.
I just love how it's cutting sweet potatoes, not regular potatoes. I mean, we got to get in depth on what he was cutting.
Gotta make
sweet
sure
potatoes.
That he was being healthy, right? Got to make sure he was trying to stay in shape.
Exactly. Yeah, it wasn't French fries. It was sweet potatoes. He was being healthy about it.
So Gibson's in net for the Ducks. McElhinney in net for the Hurricanes. Now, seemingly, they're starting goaltender because Mrazek hasn't been good and Scott Darling was sent on waivers. A lot to ask for a guy who's significantly older than John Gibson, who's played less career games than John Gibson. Gibson played his 200th career game last night. McElhinney hasn't even hit that point in his entire career, and he's 35 now. He's been great as of late. They said something in the broadcast, but it was after he went to Columbus is really where he started, picking up his career and getting a lot better as a backup. Did well there, did well in Toronto, doing really well in Carolina right now. But an interesting matchup to see a guy they gave a 4-year, $16 million contract to get sent down to Charlotte. Well, lost Jason, so we'll continue from here, I guess. Some people... Oh, wait, here he's coming back. There you go.
I'm back. I don't know what happened, but all of a sudden it froze, and you got a stupid face. You're frozen again. What's going on?
Yeah, you're back. It's all right, good.
We're good.
All right, so let's let's finish off the rest of the pregame notes here. Is Ben Street cleared waivers, still with the team, healthy scratch again tonight. Kind of feels like they're fishing to see if somebody will take him, maybe, or they're just doing it to create roster space or just have that option to be able to send him down whenever they want to. But he sticks around. So into the first period, it started off kind of back and forth, which I'm a little bit surprised with. Carolina definitely came out, I think, the hotter team. But this is a team who puts a lot of pucks on net, and they've done it all season. And they've actually done it for the last couple seasons where they've just been a really good puck possession team. And they usually control shot attempts. Nick Ritchie comes out flying, gets a pretty good piece of Evgeny Svechnikov, or of Andrei Svechnikov, sorry, and gives him a pretty good shot from behind, just kind of showing the rookie that he's going to be there for most of the night. And Svechnikov's a big guy. He's 6'3".
He didn't look like it on that shove, man.
No.
He went down pretty easy. And he kind of laid there, threw his legs up. He's like, oh, I got pushed. Penalty? Nothing? All right.
Yeah.
I'll get back up.
He's like one of those guys, I think, even especially right now, because this is his first year in the league, but he doesn't necessarily look 6'3", like you said, or really utilize that frame that he has. He's also not a big guy yet. He's still kind of lanky, but he's only 18, so that's going to change. But Nick Ritchie kind of bullied him a little bit early on. Not a lot of pressure from either team for the first 5 minutes. Dotson takes a penalty for slashing. Sherwood, again, on a line with Kess and Cogs again. Some solid chances from that line for the first half of the PK. So, that line, again, they've been put together a lot lately. I thought they looked better in this game. They were getting a little bit of PK time here and there. But it was definitely a better effort from those guys, and it had to be because going up against that top unit in Carolina is pretty difficult.
Yeah, I mean, I liked Sherwood on that line. Even though Silverberg traditionally has that role there, I think a little bit of speed. Even though Cogs is on there, I don't know. I feel like the speed is good, and then having Kessler in there, you know, trying to do Kessler things to some degree of success. Is good. It's put Silverberg somewhere else right now. He hasn't really been performing like he had been prior to his injury early in the season. So needs something to spark him. It's not going to be sparked on that line. So might as well give young guy a little bit of Sherwood a little bit of a look on a higher up line. So he's not playing just fourth line minutes necessarily. So, and you want, you know, as crappy as it is to go on the penalty kill like the Ducks have, it's also great when you have the goalie from last year who had the highest penalty killing save percentage. He's in the 90s. That's unreal. I think it's also underrated. If you get a goalie who's that good when they should be scored on, that tells me a load of stuff. As a goalie, like, I mean, I'm anticipating probably a goal going in one out of every four times in my league, let alone the upper echelon leagues of the NHL. So the fact that you have to change your game to anticipate more great chances against you and still come out on top most of the time, over 9%, 9 out of 10 times, that's a really good thing to have in a goalie. That's my hot take right there.
Hot take. It's been a real reason why the Ducks penalty kill over the last few years, even this year, has been somewhat decent this year and been one of the top in the league over the last 5 years. Speaking of John Gibson, you pointed out his mask yesterday, his Jurassic Park mask, which is pretty sweet. Yeah, a little bit of a close up from it. So if you guys didn't see it's a pretty awesome mask. He's had some great masks all year though.
Yeah. I didn't know if it was the guy we interviewed, the custom paints.
Shell Shock.
There we go. Yeah, I don't know if that was his, but the original mask he had on, he took a shot in the first period that kind of hit off one of the clips or something or busted it. So he went and got a new one, and then so they were zooming in on it. It said Jurassic Duck on the side, and I was like, I'm a goalie. I love dinosaurs. This is great. So took a fun picture of that one. So yeah, check it out on Twitter and Facebook. I put it there.
Well, thanks to that power play for Carolina, that's where they, we'll get to it later on, but that's where they generated most of their chances throughout this entire game. Shots were 8-1 at that point. If you just came in at that point and looked at the shots, it didn't look like a really good game for the Ducks. But again, a lot of the chances were generated on the power play. Akasha seemed to be playing pretty good in that first period. He was all over the place, still playing with Henrik and Richie, which was a little bit of a surprise for me that they didn't want to pop him back up with Getzlaf and Raquel. Getzlaf obliterates McGinn with a hit, trying to change some momentum because things weren't necessarily going the Ducks' way. Shots were 9-2 Carolina at that point. Ducks just needed more of something to happen. There really hadn't been a big hit since the opening minute where Nick Ritchie leveled Svechnikov, and that was pretty much it. A couple back and forth there, nothing really going on. Jake Bean gets his first penalty, and the Ducks go to the power play, narrow the shots a little bit, 12-5.
But I gotta talk about that penalty because that was such a weak call. Like, literally, I think it was Kasha, or no. It was one of the fourth line guys is coming in, and he literally just gave him a tap on the shin guards as he went to dump the puck in. And for that to be your first penalty of your career and get called for slashing on it, it was probably the worst penalty I've ever seen called. If that happened to the Ducks, I'd be like, you got to be kidding me. So
yeah,
good on your first penalty for not getting anything close to a penalty.
Yeah, and the Ducks don't even utilize it as an effective power play. Because there was 3 shorthanded shots and 0 power play shots for the Ducks. Best chance of the game went to Carolina on that power play for the Ducks, where they got a semi-break that Gibby had to stop. And maybe it was harder than it looked for a goalie is what you put here. So maybe explain what you meant by that.
So not only did he come, what I meant by that was that it was almost a breakaway, and then there was a little bit of a back check at the last moment that kind of hit the player, and the player kind of flung it at the net, for a goalie, you're expecting a quick, precise play, and for something to go really half speed for you can completely throw you off. Your timing completely. So it's much more difficult. Honestly, if he had just come in and made his move, that's a lot easier for a goalie to anticipate, move with him, and time it right. When something kind of screws it up, all of a sudden you got to start to take into account, all right, is that puck going to flip up? Is it coming this way? Is it going in a weird direction? How fast is it going? Now I've got to change everything I'm about to do at the last minute because of that little thing. But he hung with it. He stayed in there and ultimately stayed in a good enough position that the rebound came right at him, and his blocker was just chilling up high, and yeah. That rebound shot went right off, and he didn't even move it. He was just like there. He's like, I'll take it. So, not only the first stop where you have to, reevaluate how that play is going to develop, but also be in position and lucky enough in a position to take away that goal, because that could have been a killer right there, especially shorthanded.
Yeah, it wasn't a great power play from the Ducks, but they take another penalty. Gibbons goes off for a high stick, and then about, I think, 20, 30 seconds later, Carolina takes a slashing call, and it goes to 4-on-4. This leads right up until Svechnikov's goal, but Dougie Hamilton gets a breakaway, which John Gibson has to make a save, and then the Canes come back the other way, and Aho feeds, I believe it's Teravainen. I'd have to double-check that, but either way, he drops it for Andrei Svechnikov, who makes kind of an underrated play here. He does what Ovechkin has done for so long, where he uses the defenseman as a screen. He kind of skates a little bit back towards the blue line to put himself between Lindholm and John Gibson, and fires it right between Lindholm's legs and through Gibson. And I mean, it's an underrated play for Svechnikov, because not only does he use Lindholm as a screen, he uses about two or three other guys. Another Ducks player and his own player. So what looks like kind of a soft goal for John Gibson is really one that he just couldn't see. I mean, he wasn't expecting it, and Svechnikov has such a hard release that all it had to do was just find a spot at that point.
Yeah, I mean, it's you have two ways to score that as a shooter. One is that it touches nobody, and the goalie never sees it, and it just goes in beautifully. The other one is if you shoot it hard enough and you get a little bit of deflection, if the goalie can see it, a deflection will possibly put it in a spot that the goalie wasn't expecting. So you kind of have two good things when you have screens in front and a hard shot. So it may look bad to the untrained eye of people watching it, because it didn't look like Gibby even moved for it. But when you can't see it, you're not going to start randomly moving where it could possibly go, because it could go anywhere at that point. So it was a good shot. It was a great screen in front by everybody, and Lindholm included. And feel bad because Gibby had been playing so well, and I think that was their 19th shot on goal in the first period. So I mean, at that point, even if goalies are going to get tired at some point facing too many shots and too many chances, and so there's just the 19th shot, the fact they only gave up one goal, tip your cap to them, especially on that one where if you don't see it, you're not going to stop it. I mean, you just hope it hits you.
Yeah, and after that, I mean, the first period, the fact that the Ducks were only down 1-0 was pretty lucky, to be honest. The shots were 20-5. The chances were a lot slimmer than that, especially 5-on-5. Like Brady said, a lot of what Carolina generated in that first period and throughout the game came on the power play. I think they had 6 power play chances by the time the game was over. So not a horrible game at 5-on-5 when you have to consider that Carolina is a team that generally all season has dominated at 5-on-5 against pretty much every team. They're up there with the Sharks and being two of the best teams in the league at this point. So I would take that any day of the week, especially, again, when you look at the difference in shot margin. We head into the second period where the Ducks actually started to turn things around. I mean, the Montour does take an early penalty for puck over glass.
I wouldn't even really blame him on that one. That was kind of like he was given a pass into his feet, and at the same time he's being pressured. So I think the pass wasn't very good, and fortunately he just flips it over. So I don't want to put too much on beautiful Montour.
Yeah, and it does end up hurting the Ducks. I mean, just the puck movement on the Canes power play is unreal to watch that, and just see the difference that you see between the Ducks. The not just the quickness of the passes, but the decisiveness when you get the cross crease passes and the passes that put guys in dangerous positions. And I think the only fault of the Canes power play was they weren't shooting the puck sometimes in those dangerous positions. They were kind of looking for that perfect pass with the basically it's to an empty net. So that was maybe the only thing that they had to do on their power play. Luckily, the Ducks, it didn't happen. Gibson does make a pretty good save on Falk at the end of the power play. This was after Cogliano got a penalty for high sticking, so the penalties just kept continuing to rack up for the Ducks this game. Of course, the broadcast mentioned the penalty disparity. They brought it up, how the Ducks are like negative 190 something over the last five or six seasons, and Carolina's on the complete opposite end where they're like plus 215 over the last five years. So they're on the complete opposite end of the spectrum where they don't take a lot of penalties, but you knew you knew the ref discussion was going to come up.
They're gonna frame it that way for a while until things change. But that's the difference in styles between what Carolina has been doing versus what the Ducks have been doing. And it's, you know, the big bad Ducks, and they're gonna be that way for a while. So it's if you're looking for it to change, it's not going to. I just want consistency. And you know, if the Ducks take penalties, they take penalties. You know, if they're legit, that's what I care about. Are they good penalties? Or are they not? You know, it's just. I don't like the phantom penalties, so that's the only time I get pissed.
And I mean, the Ducks just started building some pressure from here. Kessler gets a chance all alone in front, which is tough for him because he's, I guess, been kind of snake-bitten, but just also on a drought. He's only got, I believe, one goal so far this season, so that would have been nice to have him cash on that one. Unfortunately, he doesn't. Now they have
Kessler?
Kessler's
good.
One goal in his last 20 games.
So it's been a while.
Okay. So Aberg was now out with Getzlaf and Raquel. So Randy Carlyle switching a couple things up, trying to get some things going. And that line was actually generating some good pressure. Then Kessler's line comes back out again. Cogliano walks out from the boards, gets a good chance on McElhinney. They were starting to get good positions, but they were still throwing it right into the chest protector on McElhinney.
Yeah, I felt like they, at that point, were halfway through the game. They hadn't hit double digits in shots yet, and they're looking at the other team throwing up 20-plus shots already, or 20 in the first period. So I think they kind of maybe wanted to just see if maybe a quick shot might fool a goalie who hasn't seen a whole lot of pucks and see if that can kind of go in. But McElhinney, he's on his game, has been for, you know, the last couple of seasons now, so... I'll give him credit for trying. Throw it out there, see what happens. All that needs to happen is one goes in, then maybe you start getting a shaky goalie who's thinking he's having an off game.
Yeah, but I mean, for a guy like that's his bread and butter. That's the types of saves that really he makes on a regular basis. He tries to get his body behind pretty much everything. So when you're shooting it right in there, he loves it, and he's in the zone. He's building confidence off that. But the Ducks were starting to dominate. There wasn't a lot of chances that Carolina were getting, like high danger chances in this period. The Ducks turned the ties in the shot attempts. They were actually leading at the end of the second period. The only other play that Carolina really had that you looked at to say they could have scored on was Gibson had to make a big save on Trevor Van Riemsdyk. It didn't end up looking like a massive save because he was in a good spot positionally, and it looked like a pretty good glove save because of how well he tracked the puck. But it's one of those underrated saves that John Gibson makes where he's just tracking the puck so well that he can put himself in such a good position to make the save look easy.
Yeah, and there was a lot of stuff happening in front, which is, you know, an easy way to kind of lose the puck if a lot of stuff's happening right in front of you. But if you're dialed in, you're zoned in on that puck, you somehow, it's really weird for goalies where if you're so dialed in, it doesn't really even matter what's happening in front. You're just so dialed in on where that puck is going and who it's going to, and you're just spatially aware of where people are that you can almost see that play happening and you're already ahead of it. And he does that a lot, and he's really, really focused on the puck. And that one play, it was over. I know Van Riemsdyk probably would have tried to go a little bit higher on that shot because it wasn't, you know, the top shelf, which he had room and time to try and do.
Yeah.
But Gibby's not giving him a whole lot to look at anyway, so he would have had to have put it in a perfect shot. And even then, I don't know, Gibby was out challenging pretty hard too. So I'm not sure, even if he had put it where he wanted to, Gibby would have given him much room to actually make a goal.
Yeah, I don't think so. But No, the Ducks really piled on the pressure to end that period. They outshot Carolina 9-6. Those shots in total were 26-14. Kane still had the 1-0 lead, but in this period, 5-on-5, I think this was one of the Ducks' better periods where they hadn't scored a goal. Because, again, like I said, Carolina is one of the best teams 5-on-5 when you're looking at possession teams in the league, but the Ducks controlled over 70% of shot attempts. They had 10 scoring chances to Carolina's 3, and they had 7 high danger chances to Carolina's 2. So they were really controlling play. Again, they couldn't put the high danger chances in the back of the net, which is something the Ducks have struggled with all year. But just being able to do that against a team who not only had 3 days of rest, but the Ducks are also on the end of 3 games in 4 nights as well. Yeah. So that's pretty impressive when you look at how tired they looked on the back-to-back. And they, you know, they got that day rest, they used it well, and they looked energized and ready to go.
Yeah, and the second period's notoriously bad for the Ducks, too. So the fact that they came out were not only able to keep up given their recent schedule, but their you know, long-standing second-period problems, it's good to see, a good omen for the third period, I guess.
Yeah, and again, the third period was probably the most boring period of the whole game, because not really much happened. Gibson had to stop Martinuk on a half breakaway, but if you're going to pick anybody on the Canes to have a breakaway, it'd probably be Jordan Martinuk, because he's not a guy who's normally going to put the puck in the back and on a regular basis. Gibson still
he's been good this season. The only reason I know that is he's on one of our fantasy teams. So on one of my fantasy teams, he's actually tearing it up. Like, oh, neat. I didn't know this guy even existed. So, all right.
Yeah, I think he had a hat trick probably a couple weeks
early
ago.
Early in the season.
But, I mean,
I thought it was early. Oh, yeah, he did, yeah.
Yeah, but if you're going to pick between him or Aho or Teravainen, I think you're going to have him. But fourth line was generating some good chances, getting a couple good chances, getting some good zone time, which is what we've seen for them lately. Since Carter Roundy's come back on that fourth line, they've looked a lot better.
Yeah, they look way more. They look really dangerous. I mean, even when Sherwood was out there, I was always impressed. They always just seem to have energy. They seem to be dumping it in and being one of the best forechecking lines, and definitely one of the quickest lines. Like, Kasha is the quickest guy we've got, the fastest guy. But I mean, as a whole line, they just seem like they're on top of it. They're moving. They'll make mistakes here or there, but they, you know, I guess that comes with, you know, only playing like 8 minutes a game, so you got a little bit of energy, I guess.
Yeah.
But I've really enjoyed Roundy coming back and you know, being on that fourth line. It's so good to be able to throw that out there and it not be like the fourth line of old, where it used to be those guys had to come in, hit some bodies, try and turn momentum around that way. At least the fourth line now has speed. They can create excitement and chances just through their speed. Not necessarily the finishing skill, but that's why they're on the fourth line.
Yeah. As long as they're creating chances, I think that's what they're there for. That's kind of the model of the modern-day fourth line. But this leads to arguably the best save of the game from anybody. In this case, it was John Gibson. Di Giuseppe breaks away alone. A third straight game where a guy breaks up through the middle on the Ducks. But he breaks up through the middle, goes to the backhand on what I thought was a great move, because John Gibson bites on it. But it's one of those situations where you kind of just have the glove up there and you hope that it flies right into the glove. It's a great save from him, but he's just got the glove up there hoping it goes into it. Di Giuseppe throws it right into the glove, but it does look like a pretty nice save from John Gibson.
Yeah, those are the ones that goalies go, all right, thank you, I can go home now. Yeah. It's just, you made my night, thank you. It made me look really good, even though I really didn't have much of a chance on it. And I've done that a few times too, and you just kind of, you laugh because you're like, oh God, I'm going to look horrible. Oh, it's in my glove. All right, sweet. This is all good. So right place. And once again, sometimes you just be big, take up as much as you can in the net. Even if you get beat, don't give up on a play. That's a great way to just do it. Just hang it out there. Who knows? A lot of times they're looking at what's going to stop them, and you ultimately end up shooting it into that spot.
Yeah. Aberg takes a penalty for tripping right after that. The Ducks kill off the penalty. The Carolina didn't really have much going on at that point. That was probably one of the Ducks' better penalty kills of the game. But this is where Slavin takes a penalty for interference. Ducks go back to the power play. And this was probably one of their better power plays because somebody told Getzlaf that he was going to be the shooter on this power play for once. He gets a couple blasts off. One of them hits off the crossbar inches from going in. It beat McElhinney easily. And it was probably a couple inches from being off the inside part of the post and in the back of the net. Really close there, but I don't know why they don't get Getzlaf to shoot more. We're always asking for a trigger guy on the power play, and he's got one of the best one-timers on the team.
He's got a bomb of a shot, and you know, just looking at those shots, they're heavy in addition to that. And even if he doesn't just bomb the shot, he's really good about doing that move where he kind of has it out and pulls it into his feet. When you do that, from a goalie's perspective, it changes the angle, but the goalie's not going to move with that. He's going to probably stay locked in that position, but now you can easily take that in and you can do it short side. You can do it high, far side. You gain more options than just leaving it out there. So I don't think it's anyone saying, hey, you know, Getzlaf, don't shoot. I need you to pass more. I don't think anyone's been telling him that. He's been told his whole career, you got a bomb of a shot, shoot. But he's just of that mindset, kind of like Joe Thornton, where it's like, I know I got a good shot, but man, I could set up a really nice, you know, slam dunk play. And he almost finds more gratification of making a beautiful pass than it would be a beautiful shot. He's more of that type of player, so I don't think you'll ever get him out of that mindset, unfortunately.
No, it's tough, especially when we don't really have a guy like that on the power play, and that's almost what you need to have a successful power play when you look at, obviously, Ovechkin and Stamkos when he was doing that in Tampa Bay, and now Vancouver's got Elias Pettersson who does that, and you know, every team who seems to have some success on the power play has that one guy who is set up for the one-timer, and the Ducks just, I don't think they've really ever had that, so... It sucks it's not Getzlaf because he would probably be the best one to put there, but this does lead into the Ducks' only goal in regulation by Pontus Aho.
Wins the puck in the corner, back for Henrik. Tries to pop it in front, that went off the side of the goal, he scored! He batted it out of midair!
Adam Henrik, who scored the goal.
Yeah.
But it ends up being Pontus Aho who puts it in, it goes to review. Henrik bounces it up off of Carolina Hurricanes defenseman. And it pops up above the crossbar, initially drops right below. Both of them wait to the perfect time to swing at it because both their sticks were under the crossbar. The review didn't take long, and Pontus Aho has his 7th of the season that ties the game with less than 4 minutes to go.
Is he's leading the Ducks in goals? I mean, I know Nick Ritchie is really close scored, behind him.
Yeah. If either of them scored, they would have been leading with 7. So now he's got 7.
Yeah. Come on, Henrik. What's wrong with you? Get to that puck.
I know, right?
Yeah, yeah. Who would have thought? And one of those games where it's just you're not doing a whole lot. The game doesn't quite look like it's going your way, and then you just get one of those fluky goals that ends up kind of being the difference maker, at least getting you at least a point out of it, if not more, hopefully. So you keep plugging away. That's kind of been their motto. It's like even if we suck this period, this shift. It just stick to the game plan, see what ends up happening. We'll just, you know, we're not going to panic about it. So they, you know, they stick to it and they get rewarded right at the end.
Yeah, I mean, this team has scored a lot of goals at all this year. So any goal that goes in the back of that, no matter how ugly it is, if it's a goal that bounces up off a defenseman, you bat it out of midair, that's whatever. The Ducks will take it at this point, especially in a close game. And it ends up taking them to overtime where they decide to, and I think this is because of the pressure that Carolina put on in 3-on-3. I haven't seen it from any team. The Ducks held the puck for the first minute of overtime in their own end, pretty much. They kept trying to get out. They couldn't really get any outlet or anything like that. They circled back. They made a change. Getzlaf comes out. The pressure that Carolina puts in OT is an interesting strategy because it can work to some extent if they end up getting the puck, and they came close a couple times. But then in this instance, it doesn't work because that pressure doesn't pay off where Hampus Lindholm throws a strike up the middle to Ryan Getzlaf, who's wide open because the Hurricanes went for a bad change. He's snucking behind them, makes a great move from backhand to forehand and puts it over the glove hand of Curtis McElhinney.
So beautiful. I love it when he gets chances like that. It's the opposite feeling I have, you know, like if Cogliano's going, I have one set of feelings on that breakaway. When Getzlaf gets a breakaway, it's the exact opposite of the feeling. You almost feel like something good should happen. He'll make something good happen. One of those rare players that, you know, it's kind of cliche where he's got the size and the hands to go along with it. And he's not all that slow. He kind of looks slow, but he's not really all that slow of a player anyways. Gets himself in a good position, a little fortunate there that, like you said, the Hurricanes kind of maybe did a little bit of a bad line change that kind of came back to bite him. But, you know, for 3-on-3 and to get a breakaway chance like that is you got to bury it, and he did it. And so we win. We somehow win again.
How about Hampus Lindholm in his first game back, too? Making a pass like that, because I mean, we look back in the Edmonton game where it was Brandon Montour with the exact same play from his own zone
Raquel.
With the pass to Raquel, and now you get Hampus Lindholm with a similar pass on the other side of the ice to Ryan Getzlaf. I don't know if this is a new strategy from the Ducks, just waiting for them to change into sitting in your own end and going for the home run pass, but it's worked twice so far.
Yeah, and oddly enough, both of those games were 2-1 overtime wins, and the Ducks didn't look good in either one of those until the end. They scored a late third-period goal and won it in overtime.
Randy Carlyle's happy because he said the Ducks need to win more 2-1 games, and now they've won two,
I was going to bring that up, too.
2-1 games, yeah. So he's probably...
3-2 game.
Yeah, he's definitely gassed up a bit, and his ego's getting a nice boost for that, so he's... he thinks he's looking pretty good for that, because obviously the Ducks do end up getting the 2-1 win in overtime against Carolina. The Ducks have now won three straight and five of their last six.
Yeah, you think, I wonder if he's happy in the way that when we do the Forever Mighty three stars before every game, like someone gets all three right and goes, I knew it was going to happen. Yeah, I called it. Yeah, I knew. I knew exactly what they needed to do and who was going to do what, and that's how it worked out. It's like, you're lucky. That's pretty much it.
All it does is keep his job for him a little bit longer, because now he's, you know, he's just saying things, and if they work out, then he looks really good, because he's not saying
he wasn't saying much early on, and things weren't going. Now it's like, we need to win games 2-1. And then they start winning 2-1. See, told you.
Yeah.
I mean, keep the seat nice and warm here.
He's not saying anything that can get him in trouble, because if they don't win games 2-1, or if they win games in a different fashion, it's like, whatever, we're scoring more goals now. So he's just saying something that if it does work out, it looks pretty good for him. But, I mean, now he has to be easily safe. It might not be his fault that the Ducks have won five of their last six and won three in a row. Again, you know, if we're being so harsh on him this year, which, you know, for good reason, but I think with the Ducks' recent success, you have to give him credit along with the players. You can't just say it's his fault for everything and then not give him some praise in getting the Ducks to five wins out of the last six and three in a row. So obviously something, whatever it is, has changed, and the Ducks have been able
to put a finger on it.
Yeah, the Ducks have been able to string together a lot of close wins against some pretty good teams.
Goaltending.
Yes, for sure. The last two games before this in Florida and Tampa, Ryan Miller and John Gibson in those back-to-back games were outstanding. John Gibson was good in this game too.
33 stops.
For sure. And I think most of his work, again, came on the power play. Carolina had like 15 of those shots on the power play. So, so they did a lot of their work there. And again, that's what you said with John Gibson. His PK save percentage comes in huge when you're going in these games where, you know, you're going up against a good team who's pretty good and has been pretty good as of late on their power play. And you've got a guy who's shutting them out and is kind of a career guy at doing that as well.
Yeah, and I've had a few people kind of come up to me going, hey, Ducks are winning. Ducks are doing good. They're doing great, right? Like, expecting me to go, yeah, we're winning. We're finally doing it. And I'm sitting there, I'm going like, we're winning, but, you know, you want to give credit to Randy Carlyle. But, I mean, the beginning of the season, I think we started 5-1. But the whole time I'm looking and going, like, we're 5-1 because of our goalies. It's not the way we're playing. The play isn't that great. Now, our play has gotten better, and especially lately after Nashville, our play has been much better these last three games. But it's still nowhere near where it needs to be for the rest of the season, come playoff time, anything like that. So it's still underlying issues. Goaltending is masking a lot of those issues. One or two of those goals easily could have gone in. We never get to overtime, and we're right back going like, man, you know, is Carlisle in trouble? Is Carlisle going to get, you know, fired, this, that, and the other? And it's just, is goaltending is the other thing that's really kind of bailing them out. The fact that we're only scoring two or three goals a game, good for three, but at the same time, it's just, there needs to be more. We're one of the lowest scoring teams and one of the highest giving up shots. I mean, that's a recipe for disaster, and it's got to change. And until that starts changing, I'm still not a huge fan of Carlisle's coaching strategy at this point.
Oh yeah, and don't get me wrong, I'm still not a fan.
No, you said you love Carlisle. I think, yeah. I heard you say that. You said you love him.
I'm still not a fan of Randy Carlisle by any means, but we've given him a lot of criticism, and pretty much everybody has, rightfully so, all year. But when the Ducks are playing well, there's different levels of reasoning and putting success on some guys. And like you said, goaltending definitely gets a lot of the attribute for success over the last five wins that the Ducks have had. But some credit can go to the other players as well, of course. And then I think marginal credit at least has to go to the coaching staff for at least changing something around to get them to that point. And I don't think it's a lot, and I'm not saying Randy Carlisle's out of the woods by any means, but it's not only one or two things that are getting it done. And I still think Randy Carlisle should be gone, but that's just the way it is right now. He's not, so.
Yeah, he made a great decision to play Lindholm today. Good job, Randy.
Yeah. Hampus Lindholm had a great game, too. So
yeah.
Let's move on to some of the stuff we have in post-game. One thing that we have here is talking about Andrei Svechnikov and how earlier in the draft, before him and Rasmus Dahlin got drafted, there was some discussion, and we had Steve Kournianos on before that draft, who talked about how he thought Andrei Svechnikov should go number one and Rasmus Dahlin should go number two. Obviously, that didn't happen. Buffalo's pretty happy, I think, getting Rasmus Dahlin. Carolina was just happy to be at that spot and get Andrei Svechnikov. Yeah, but he's kind of been forgotten almost, and he's been cast in the shadow of Rasmus Dahlin, who started to play very well with a Buffalo team who had won 10 games in a row. Svechnikov is struggling. He's been up and down the lineup. They haven't really put him on the first line. He's been playing, I think, lately with Martinuk and Lucas Walmark, which is not a line you would have expected this to be on. A difficult spot for him to be in, especially for a young kid.
Yeah, it's tough, and especially since number one was so highly publicized and has made such an impact on that Buffalo team. He was fifth in for rookies in goals scored, for an 18-year-old, there's rookies who are 19, 20, that had a little bit more seasoning in the minors. So for him to kind of come in just into the NHL, play on a Carolina team that's been impressive, to say the least, kind of coming in, because I didn't really have huge amount of faith in them. I thought they could surprise teams a little bit, but they've been doing really well. And to have him kind of come in and be, just another cog in the wheel that's kind of helped out to get some goal scoring other than Aho or Teravainen or anybody like that, or Martin Took. I can't pronounce his name. it's good. It's what you maybe want from an 18-year-old, but he's been a little overshadowed because, once I saw his name, they go, oh, he went second overall. I'm like, he did? Huh.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah, I think because, you look at what he did in the OHL, but obviously then he got injured and he had World Juniors as well. He was in some historic territory in the amount of goals he was put in the back net. He was almost at a goal per game. I think he had 40 goals in 44 games with Barry in the OHL. Just ridiculous numbers. Not many guys can do that, especially at that age. And that's his first experience with that league as well. So I think that's where a lot of the hype came from. But I think eventually he'll get there. But, a guy who's 6'3", coming in close to 200 pounds, you're expecting this guy to just easily step right in, and go right onto that top line in Carolina, because they didn't necessarily have top right winger, you know, play with Aho and Teravainen and put 30 goals in the back of that. That's what I thought he was going to do, and he could still do that. He's at six now. If he eventually gets up to that first line, he is playing some power play. His minutes are starting to increase. Maybe he'll get that confidence and go on a roll. I mean, you look at Patrick Laine, put 18 goals in the month of November. I mean, it can happen. You can go on a streak. And Patrick Laine is an amazing player and probably one of, if not the best goal scorer in the National Hockey League. So that's a lofty comparison. But I can see Svechnikov putting 10 goals in a month and getting back on track. So it'll be interesting. But, yeah, you're comparing it to Rasmus Dahlin, who's having a good year, and Brady Tkachuk, who was drafted two picks after him, who's having an excellent start in Ottawa and is over a point per game right now. And even Jesperi Kotkaniemi, who was drafted one pick after him, who's playing in Montreal right now and having some similar struggles. But, you know, a lot of comparisons going out. Then a lot of guys like Elias Pettersson, who they're comparing him with. But, again, Pettersson is also a year older than this guy as well. Kind of expected that he was going to come over and have such a good start as well. So it's tough comparing him to all those guys. I think for what he's doing, he's still doing pretty well. Tough a lot of these times, and especially for the Euros coming over. Even though Svechnikov has played in North America for the last two or three seasons, it's always a tough transition for some of these guys as well. Not a lot of Russians in the Carolina locker room either, which can always make things difficult. And yeah, you know, it sounds like we're chalking up a lot of excuses, but things don't always go best case scenario for a lot of these rookies coming into the league. Sometimes it takes a little bit of time for them to get going, but I think this guy is going to be a consistent 20-30 goal scorer once he finally gets ready and established in this league.
He's got plenty of time and a long career ahead of him.
Exactly, yeah. So let's move on to our second topic we have, and it is kind of a revisit of a trade that happened earlier this year between the Calgary Flames and the Carolina Hurricanes, where the Hurricanes received Michael Ferland and Dougie Hamilton, Adam Fox as well, but he's not playing with them this year. He's playing the NCAA. And Calgary received Noah Hanifin and Elias Lindholm. And, you know, what at first looked like Carolina probably got the best player in the deal, maybe that's still true in Dougie Hamilton. This is a trade where you don't say it often when you have some big names like that. It really worked out for both teams.
Yeah, I mean, Elias Lindholm's been, you know, they said a revelation there in Calgary. So, I mean, they got what they wanted, which is someone that can, you know, put in goals. And I would say, I don't want to say underutilized in Carolina, but just the change of scenery seemed to really kind of spark him. I was always kind of waiting for him to show that, because every now and again I'd watch him play and I'd go like, oh, he's got some skill. There's something in there waiting for it to kind of show itself. You go to a more offensive team like Calgary, quick strike team like Calgary, and he's kind of been a real big help on that, you know, that squad. But at the same time, Carolina's really happy with what they got with a man whose name is Dougie. It still blows me away someone would call himself Dougie instead of Doug. But you know, but he looked good. He had his chances. You know, it's one of those guys who he's always, at least the last couple of seasons, been up there among defensemen, shots on goal. Kind of plays right into what Carolina's doing as far as just unloading shots on teams. He fits right into that mold, and so it's kind of just a nice little change where both of them kind of have fit very nicely as a puzzle piece into the bigger picture of both teams. So you can't say there's a loser in that trade. They both kind of got what they were looking for.
Yeah, because you look at, like you said, how Elias Lindholm almost turned out, and Carolina's waiting for that forever. And it's one of those situations where a change of scenery actually helps a guy. Or also playing now with Monahan and Goodrow does help a guy.
Shocker.
As well. But Elias Lindholm is a really skilled player. He always has been, and you know, that's helped him out a lot, and he's done really, really well in Calgary. And I think that just that system and the way they play there fits him a lot better than what they're trying to do with him in Carolina. Noah Hanifin has been decent. He just picked up his first two goals for the Flames a couple days ago. So he's starting to kind of gel in there and get used to it. And it's a tough position for him to be in because he's playing behind Giordano. And you know, he's still a young kid, and he got traded from a team that put a lot of faith in him, and that could that could sometimes hurt the ego a bit, but I think he's starting to get a little bit more confident there and things are going for him. And then, you know, you look at Dougie, he's not having the offensive type of season that he had last year, but he's still putting shots on net. They said in the broadcast yesterday, he's second in the league in defensemen for shots. So eventually some of those are going to start going in the back of the net, and he's going to get back to close to where he was last year, where he was leading the NHL in goals by defensemen. I think he had 18 or something last year, which is ridiculous. So that will be something he'll continue to do probably for the rest of his career. Just that's the type of defenseman he is. And then underrated, I think the most underrated piece of this trade was Michael Ferland, because he is kind of like a Tom Wilson type guy where everybody thought he was just a dirty kind of grinding player, a guy who was benefiting at times from playing on that top line in Calgary with Monahan and Goodrow, and he wasn't really that good. He comes over, impresses them, and then they put him on the top line with Aho and Teravainen, and he does really well. He's in the double digits in goals right now. He was out with injury. He's day-to-day with an injury in the game against the Ducks. But he's been an impressive player for them as well, because he's something they really didn't have in that physical presence. They just had a really young, offensively gifted team, but they didn't really have that guy who made teams kind of sit up on edge and watch out. Because, I mean, this guy puts up 5-6 hits a night, and they're generally punishing hits when he's out there. So that adds a whole new dynamic to their team I think they're missing, and it's a really underrated piece of that trade too.
Yeah, I wonder if that's kind of the new thing that NHL teams are going to look for. Hey, we got some top-end talent, but we don't necessarily have that the hitter that can also put in the puck. Like Tom Wilson does it, and now Ferland does it, and, you know, these two teams that have done, you know, much better. I mean, Marchand's on the top line, although he's not a big dude. I mean, he's a guy you got to have to kind of watch out for as well. So I wonder if that's, you know, a new trend, or if that's just, you know, a couple teams get that lucky guy that just works on in that situation.
Yeah.
So be interesting to see.
It's almost, in some sense, the new enforcer. How every team back in the day when you had enforcers, the assumption was every team needs at least one. You just need that one guy who's going to stick up for your teammates. And now I think it's transitioning into every team just needs that Tom Wilson, Michael Ferland type guy who is going to still be able to contribute offensively, but is a guy who kind of plays on the edge. Tom Wilson's case is a little bit more dirty than others, but I think if you look at the Ducks, Nick Ritchie could possibly be that guy for them. And I think you don't necessarily need
that. If he pots more goals, then I can see that. But I mean, he's that guy where it's like if there's something happening in front of the net, you give him just a little shove, he'll punch you back. he's not going to mess around too much with the physical play.
Yeah, I think you don't necessarily need that guy to win, but I think it adds a whole new element to teams. And especially if you're building a young, skilled, fast team, at a team like Edmonton and how much they could benefit from possibly having a guy like Tom Wilson or Michael Ferland. You could say Lucic is
Lucic of old.
Yeah, if they had the old Lucic, that would be a little bit different. But again, Lucic, the difference I think between him and Ferland and Wilson is he's a lot slower and a lot older than those guys, and he's just kind of a part of the old breed of that type of forward. So it's like not
Cro-Magnum looking guy.
Yeah, so it hasn't been too good. But so if moving away from that trade to talk about a trade in Ducks history that could have gone a lot differently, the Freddie Anderson trade where the Ducks ended up trading him to the Toronto Maple Leafs for a first and a second round pick that landed them Sam Steele and Maxime Comtois. I'm pretty sure everybody's happy with how that trade turned out, but in an article for The Athletic, Pierre LeBrun was saying that the Calgary Flames were another team that was interested and that were involved, and we knew that, but to what extent we didn't know until this article came out. And apparently the offer that was on the table was Freddie Anderson and the Ducks' first round pick, which is 24th overall, for the Flames, which was the 6th overall pick that they used to draft Matthew Tkachuk. Ultimately, it didn't go through because Tree Living, the GM in Calgary, wasn't comfortable giving up the 6th overall pick. But imagine a Ducks team with Matthew Tkachuk or whoever else they could have got at 6.
Yeah, McAvoy, I think, was still out there, too, as an option. So You know, between Tkachuk and McAvoy and what Bob Murray does, I'm pretty sure we still wouldn't have taken Tkachuk. We probably would have gone McAvoy because there's nothing more dear to Bob Murray's heart than a good young defenseman. And he will find them, he will hold them and pet them and nurture them until they do what he wants or he trades them to New Jersey. So it was an interesting, you know, chance. I mean, that would have been fun to get McAvoy too. But yeah, I'm not too disappointed in what we've got for Anderson. You know, at that point, we had to get rid of a goalie. I'm glad we stuck with Gibson. Some people don't; they miss Freddie for some reason. But you can't really deny how good Gibby's been. And to get two picks out of it that are going to be a nice building block for the future for us is something that we needed. We need offense more than we need defense at this point, or goaltending.
Yeah. I could have seen them going at that point 2-4 just because, and generally I agree with you that they normally go for defensemen with those high picks, but at the time they still had Shea Theodore, they still had Vatanen, they still had Montour, they, you know, obviously Fowler, Lindholm, so they still had everybody. Josh Manson was still there, so they had all these guys in place. I think at that point, when you got such a high pick, and Matthew Tkachuk just seems like such a Ducks pick. You know, you look at the fact they drafted Max Jones, and that just seems to be their type of guy. If they can go out and get him, that guy who plays on the edge, he did that in London. He did that when he was playing with the U.S. When they draft forwards, they generally like to draft those guys. That's why they went out and they got Maxime Comtois when they got that second round pick. So I think that is a direction they could have gone. I mean, imagine him playing with Ryan Getzlaf and Ricard Raquel. I mean, that would really help the Ducks right now. As much as I love Maxime Comtois and Sam Steele, I think anybody would be ridiculous to say right now that they wouldn't rather have Matthew Tkachuk, especially the way he's playing right now. And imagine being able to make that transition where having Corey Perry for, you know, 15 years and then making the transition into literally his light version,
his clone
in Matthew Tkachuk, who's going to do the same thing for the next 15 to 20 years in the NHL too.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, that would be fun to watch and have one of the Tkachuk brothers or that bloodline playing for the Ducks after so many years of hating on the dad for so long. So it's an interesting thought, so close. But, you know, that's the way NHL goes sometimes. It's just almost, not quite, what if, maybe, something like that.
Well, that pretty much does it, unless you got anything else, I think.
Nope, I've got kids that are now up and walking around, so I need to go.
All right, well, we will be back for the first game of December on Sunday against the Washington Capitals. It ends off the 5-game road trip for the Ducks. Then they'll be back home to face Chicago and Carolina to finish off the first week for December. So we'll be back for that game. We won't probably be doing it on the Sunday because all of us are busy. So it might be either Sunday night or Monday morning podcast. So we'll keep you updated for that. And stay tuned for the first Forever Mighty 3 Stars in December. That will be out before that game. I'll be calculating the winner for November today. And so I'll notify that person today when I get to that. I'll probably have time to do it later because we're recording.
It's probably me. You know, I don't even calculate. Don't just even get, worry. Just send me the message, and I'll just tell you what I want.
it will probably be after our bonus show because we're recording Pucks and Brews today. If you don't know about our bonus shows, check out our Patreon. We've got 4 different bonus shows. This one's probably the funnest one to do. We get to talk.
We've only done it once, but man, was it fun!
Yeah,
you get to join us live. You can have some beers with us, join chat, and we kind of go over different topics. But we get a little bit more candid as the alcohol flows.
Exactly. Well, make sure you check out our Patreon if you haven't yet. Subscribe to us on YouTube. Head over on iTunes, and make sure you check us out on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. All right, guys. See you Sunday. Have a good day.
Have a good one.
Thanks for ruining my show, by the way. That's it. I'm sorry you guys had to sit through that, but this is an obligation, contract obligation, they told me. So my kneecaps are sweating. I really got to go to the bathroom. So I'm going to have to let you guys go. Thank you. Bye.